But let's eavesdrop on Skippy with him now. Fred Travalena.
Fred, I'm telling you, many faces of comedy, but they call you, or I'll say I call you, the Laurence Olivia of comedy.
Well, that's very flattering. It's very flattering.
Because you really are. You're not just you're not just a comedian. Mm. You are an actor.
Yes, thank you. I studied for years. I still study. And what I try to do with that part of my work, the impressions when I do my specials,
right.
Not only the makeup, but that there's something going on as an actor
right.
that makes it real to the point where people have to do a double take.
Uh-huh.
It's not just some guy with a rubber face on. You tune in and you go, "What? Right. What's going on?" You know, I had a guy tell me once that they tuned in. I was doing George Bush.
Right.
When I first started to do George Bush in makeup, on Regis and Kathy Lee, I debuted it on the morning circuit, and this guy was sitting in his house, and he said, "I absolutely thought." For the first 2.5 minutes, it was George Bush, and so you start to say these things, and I'm saying, what did he just say?
How long does it take Fred Travalena to put that makeup on? How many hours?
My makeup man puts it on. Tom Brumberger. He won two Ace Awards for the specials.
Uh-huh.
He's, in fact, he just worked with Olympia Dukakis on a couple of films. Uh-huh. He takes 2.5 hours, 3 hours, mm-hmm. depending on which character.
Right.
And then it takes about an hour to take them off. I've tried to do them, and I have done them in concert live, mm-hmm. but it's just too much. It's 2 hours before the show, and then you have to take it off and get back out and do the regular act. So,
Fred Travalena, where is really? Back East, you're from?
Back East.
Where?
The New York Metropolitan Avenue, uh-huh. Avenue Hawaii area.
Uh-huh.
Long Island, Nassau County, Queens, uh-huh. the Bronx, say. The Bronx, you know what I mean? Skippy.
Right, right.
That's why I can do Bobby De Niro. What is the matter with you? Didn't I tell you not to buy things? Didn't I tell you not to buy things?
I'm sorry, Paul. I just thought, you know.
Uh-huh. So. Can you do that, Annie?
No, I can't, but I can sure laugh at it.
Tell me about growing up in New York in the Bronx. And also, you worked in the Village. You started really in the Village. You were with a group called La Mamas?
That's right.
Tell me about the La Mamas.
Boy, you pulled that one out. That was Ellen Stewart's La Mama Theater.
Right.
It was an off-Broadway theater. They finally moved uptown. It was the late 60s.
Right.
And in the company was Bette Midler.
Right.
And I worked with Bette Midler on a couple of different projects.
Right.
And she sent me once up to, I believe it was upstairs or the downstairs, to see a young piano player who was playing a white piano. And she said, "He'll do all your music. I'd like to go on tour with you around the city." Right. Barry Manilow.
Barry Manilow.
Wow.
Yes. Isn't that great?
God.
So you were around New York. Annie was around New York, and when I first came to.
I worked with Fred in New York.
You did.
Yeah, on a New Year's Eve in Mount Airy Lodge.
My goodness.
You did work together.
Yeah, we had the same arranger in California, and I always heard. I was always seeing Fred's charts getting ready to be picked up by some messenger. Uh-huh. When I, of course, was coming to pick up my own, and so we ended up working together on New Year's once.
Isn't that wild? Well, nice to see you. You look wonderful.
Doesn't nice
you?
To be seen.
This got me to the marriage thing.
Sally Kirkland was a La Mamba.
Was she?
Yes, she was. Well, she started with them.
Yeah,
too.
I don't know who all these.
Some of the great people were there.
But
really.
It was quite an experience.
Then what happened with Fred? I mean, you worked clubs up the mountains, the Catskills, and in Boston area.
Yeah, I started up there, and I was very grateful. Still am. I work up there a couple, three times a year. In fact, I'll be back up there this summer at the Kutcher's and the Mount Airy Lodge.
Uh-huh.
And I learned how to work an audience. I learned how to work clean. I learned. Timing, and they used to knock the tables with
the knockers. Yes, around Springfield and all that. In Connecticut. See, I like what you just said. You appreciate, and you like to work clean.
Mm-hmm.
You appreciate what you are and what you got.
Yes.
And this is, we don't have that type of comedy anymore, Fred. What's happening with it?
It's running into itself is how I look at it. It's like, there's so many people that want to do it and want to get attention doing it, and are very talented.
Shocking me.
So they have to like drive it home.
Right.
But if you watch or even listen to, I listen to some of the old Jack Benny radio shows, and they're hilarious.
Right. Absolutely.
They're just hilarious, and you're not even seeing them; you're just listening to the stuff.
Yes.
You know, but there's a lot of good stuff out there today. That's funny. That's clean. It's starting to do a turnaround.
Right.
Now, you
know. Write all your own material.
I conceptualize. Everything, and then when I need some lines to punch it up, I have a couple of writers that I use.
First character, come back. Let's
the
go back.
First character.
First character. Boy. Fred Travalena ever did. Come on.
The first voice. Character I did.
Yeah.
Was a takeoff of Johnny Ray.
Oh, I worked with him. Do you ever work Johnny? Loved him. Go ahead.
He was most people don't know, but Johnny Ray was bigger than Elvis.
That's right.
The people used to charge him down the street, and hundreds of thousands mm-hmm. of people. My dad was an impressionist entertainer, and so he did Johnny Ray. Mm-hmm. So at a party one year, he said, "If you want to be an entertainer, you got to get there and do it." Uh-huh. And I got up there and I did "If Your Sweetheart Sends a Letter of Goodbye," and I took off my clothes and I threw them on the floor and
Oh, great.
And so that was my first one. And then the one when I was in my teens was I did Crazy Guggenheim, you know, uh-huh. when I was in uh-huh. school. Uh-huh. How you doing, teach? Then when I was in the army, I used to get out of trouble all the time because I'd use this voice uh-huh. and they didn't know if I was real or not. Uh-huh. So they didn't want to laugh at me, so they'd kind of just go, "You really talk like that?" "Well, yes, I do." Uh-huh. I just love uh-huh. making my bed and everything. Shazam, you know.
Uh-huh. Studied voice. Is three octave range. Have three octave range, Fred Travalena. Did you know Fred Travalena has three octave range?
I know.
He's great. It's just
and
incredible.
And a microwave oven.
Tell me about your singing voice.
I studied with Carlo Minotti.
I did too. Of course. Dick Roman. I didn't know
Roman, yes. Tony Bennett studied with him.
The best.
And my dad put me on to him. I studied with Joe Locas first and Fred Steele, who taught Stephen Eady.
Right.
And then I was having a problem. My voice would give out when I was in Vegas.
Right.
And he used to say, "You got to do opera. You got to study opera. You got to have such a strong voice that it can never give out on you."
Right.
And so I studied with Carlo Minotti, and I'll never forget. He's still around. He's wonderful. The first time I went there,
isn't he dead?
No,
now?
I think he's still around.
Still, I hope
and,
so.
And you and me both. He's such a sweetheart.
Yes.
I went up to the studio, and he has the whole thing—the silk robe and the big uh-huh. grand piano
on 58th Street.
Yes,
I lived there too, next door to him.
Yeah, and he says, "You know what's the matter with you? It's your stomach. You'll not breathe. You have to breathe. How can you sing with no breath?" And I'm like, "Yeah, but I used to be an asthmatic." "Too bad." So he takes his belt, Skippy, and he takes his and he says, "Now, breathe." And I'm like, you know. But he really did help me.
Then TV, first television show. What was first TV? Come back, Fred. I mean, you've done so many. Think back.
Believe it or not, the Joe Franklin Show.
Really? In Jersey. I love them.
And I sat on a chair that was a movable chair. And it was one of those rocking chairs. I'm a very type A, constantly moving. And so I sat there the whole time. Look, I was davening. Uh-huh. And I didn't realize it till I watched the show played back that night that I did it through the whole show.
Uh-huh.
And he was saying, "So, Fred, you're working out at the comic club. You're seeing how he does it." I'm like, "Yes, it's wonderful." Then I did David Frost, because I had toured with David Frost in the early 70s when he was doing a nightclub act.
David Frost did a nightclub act. What? What did he do?
He had a show called That Was the Week That Was.
Right.
Then
he
had the David Frost show, the David Frost Review.
Ah.
And he toured the country doing a concert of very sophisticated political type of humor.
Right.
And I did 5 minutes in his act doing various characters.
Right.
It was my first real exposure to the boards of Las Vegas and meeting people like Phyllis Diller. And
what was your first president?
The first president was JFK.
JFK?
JFK.
Was he?
You know, I did him day when he was had that type of voice, because all the Kennedy voices are quite different.
Uh-huh.
And then I did Lyndon Johnson when I was in the army. I used to get things done like you can't believe. And of course, Richard Nixon and Law and Order.
Politics in right now. We're talking about politics now. Tell me about the politicians today. What you've done so many.
Yeah.
You put a whole thing with Bush.
Bush. Oh, yeah. And, Clinton's going to be. He's very good because he's got that southern accent going.
Right.
I will not allow you to say that. And my favorite moment was when Zongas turned around and said, "That's a lie. I have no intentions of permitting you to." And I'm like,
sounds like
"Wait
me, doesn't it?
I solemnly swear to uphold the Constitution."
I'm sorry.
Two for one. Fred.
Is it easier for you with a southern accent to do? Is it easier with the southern drawl?
Well, it all depends, you know. George.
Most actors like to get into that southern drawl.
Yeah, well, George was a piece of work, you know, kind of had to do John Wayne a little bit there and a little Liberace, combine them, and got George Bush, you know.
Uh-huh.
So it's.
Liberace and George. Okay.
That's right. Liberace and John Wayne. That's how.
Tell me, you brought a clip. I love to see this clip you brought today. What is this clip?
This is a clip from a show that won a great deal of awards, ACE Awards for makeup and everything, called The Great Debate of 88. Now, we're going to have debates this year, so I thought it'd be fun to show some of the people. I did all the characters on this show.
Right.
And with Dukakis and Bush and Nixon and Jesse Jackson and Ronald Reagan and Gorbachev. And the show aired the night before election.
Ah.
And the next morning, I was down in Florida having a photo shoot, and someone walked by and she said, I saw the show last night, you should have run.
Well, let's see it, if you could run, okay?
Okay.
Fred Travalena doing.
Now let's turn to our third guest from our studios in Chicago, the Reverend Jesse Jackson.
Good evening, Ted.
Forgive me for asking, Reverend, but are you still angry about not being picked for vice president?
I'm not mad that the man didn't have the decency to pick up the phone and tell me himself. I'm not mad. I am not mad.
But you still think you're the best candidate.
Let me just put it this way, Ted. What America needs today is a man who believes in human right, not military might. In justice and clarity, not missiles and parity. In freedoms and jobs, not shish kebab.
Well, that's all very interesting, Reverend Jackson, but...
It's time for everybody to stand up and say, I am somebody. Say it loud. Say it proud. Come on, Ted. Say it. I am somebody.
I am somebody.
Louder, Ted. Say, I am somebody. I am somebody. Come on, say it.
I am somebody. I am somebody. I am somebody. Gentlemen, please. We'll get back to our panel later. Right now, it looks like we're ready to begin, so we'll go to our distinguished...
Okay. Great, I love it. I think it's funny. What do you mean you like somebody, you know? But
the whole Ted Gobble thing.
I think it's great.
The whole play on his low key.
Annie, you were telling me that he does...
Yeah, I was working in Vegas, and we were doing this big show, which is like this big annual show they have every year, the Comdex show.
Right.
And I ran into him before the show started, and he said, I'm doing Don King. I said, hey, I know you can do everybody, but Don King?
Yeah.
And it was great. Don King
was in it. And I love this boy. Only in America. Only in America. The quintessential five team that comes together. Now, the great part was I had this fright wig on.
Right.
No makeup like that, because you had to be in and out of
it.
And I come for the first show. And who's there but Joe Frazier and 12 fighters.
Right, right.
I figure if these guys don't like this impression of Don King, it's over for me. So Joe comes over to me after the first one and he goes, Fred, that's good. You just got to yell more.
You work Vegas a lot. Tell me about Vegas. You love Vegas.
It's a great
Vegas
town.
Vegas loves you.
Well, thank you.
Because it's a middle America. People that come there to see clean comics.
Oh, yeah.
They don't get dirty there.
They're doing a turnaround, too. They're bringing a lot of headline entertainment in now, especially at the Desert Inn.
Right.
In fact, we were up there last weekend. We saw Frank Sinatra twice. Absolutely magnificent. Tom Dreesen opened the show for him. And it's growing like leaps and bounds. Every time you go up there, there's another hotel. Uh-huh. I mean, it's quite astounding.
You've worked with some big stars, Fred. Name a few, just a few.
Boy.
I mean,
Shirley MacLaine.
Shirley MacLaine loves
Anne
you.
Anne Margaret.
That's a great lady. You just
all of them.
Tell me about
Julie Andrews.
But tell me about Anne Margaret, special lady though.
Yeah, very special lady.
What makes her so special?
Because she's the sweetest person you'll ever meet, and she doesn't have any time for anything that's down or negative. She'll just say and walk away. I mean, she just is the sweetest woman, nicest woman, and her and her husband, you know, Raj.
Very calm.
Very calm and a great performer. And I always felt that people should go see her live. Not only is she a great screen actress, but when you saw her live, she really put on one of the best shows in the country. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. I don't know if she's doing it anymore, but I mean, I had the privilege of working with her.
She was in Radius and Needs Call. Great.
Oh, that's right.
She did fabulous in Radius and Needs Call. Wasn't it? I heard she was great.
That's right. I heard she was sold out.
She was absolutely great. Tell me about your POW. Fred Travalena, you're very sympathetic. You have a lot of sympathetic for people in this world. You take care of, you are on the board or you're looking?
Yes, I'm tell me about one of the public awareness people. There's a lot of them. When I first started doing it, there wasn't that many. But there's different sections of around the country. But I'm working on a new project now. I have a bill before Congress that I hope to get passed.
Right.
Called Reconciliation and Forgiveness Day.
Right.
And it's going to be in November, either 11th or 12th,
right
around Veterans Day in Washington. And basically what it is, it's a very spiritual day. It's a day of forgiveness offered up to God. I mean, we're the Judeo-Christian ethic in this country. Privately, publicly, however you want to do it.
Wonderful.
Ask forgiveness, give forgiveness, offer it up to God, and then He will work the pieces to get the remaining men out.
Right.
Because this thing has been going on for 18 years, and they're still debating, are they there, aren't they there? Enough for the families.
Right.
What would you say to one of those men? Mm-hmm. We're working on it.
Right.
Enough. Yes, let's turn it over to God in a big way.
Yes.
Let's let the politicians, the Congress know we really want to get this going and get these men home. It doesn't, whatever the reasons, it's not enough to not get them out.
I see.
It's time to get them out.
Bush. You met Bush.
Oh, yes.
He loves your character. He gave you a big honor. How does he feel about Travalena doing him?
Well, it's my favorite story. Of course, I was one of the hosts at the inaugural ceremonies, and I met him there.
How was it to be?
Oh, God.
Was it exciting?
I love presidential politics, and to be there and to be in the main flow of it was astounding. And about 3 months later, he asked me to come back for a special event and to come in the makeup. And I'm not as tall as he is, but I had these special boots where I tried to be as tall as he is. And so here I am, they had Secret Service protection, honestly had it for the whole day. And I'm backstage waiting in the holding area for him to come in. So they say, Eagle 3, whatever he is called, in he comes, and he starts shaking hands with the VIPs and Mary Hart and her husband. And as soon as he got about three people down from here, I am looking like him, And I start in, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. I pledge. He comes running over. Fred! Gee, look at that! And he put his face this close to mine. And he's looking at the nose and the teeth. He even got the thing there with my tooth. Got the air. Babs, come here. And the first lady comes over and he says, look. She goes, wow. I said, I am that man. She said, no, you're not, but I know who you are.
she gets a big kick out of you. Sweet people.
Oh, they are.
You brought a clip, another clip of...
The Great Debate.
Great Debate.
Yeah, this
we're in politics right now.
This is Larry Arnstein and Steve Barker's idea. Terry Botwick produced this show.
Right.
And I wasn't that... I said, this sounds like a very off-the-wall idea. And they said, Fred, this is going to be so funny, you got to do it. And I was wrong, and they were right.
Right.
This is a badminton match between Bush and Dukakis with Nixon as the goalie.
Okay, let's see the clip. Okay. Annie, you want to roll that clip, honey? Go ahead, Annie. Roll the clip, baby.
It's a game of badminton. I, of course, will act as line judge. George, it's your serve.
Well, this makes no sense at all. Everybody knows I'm from Texas. Why don't we pick a more manly sport like Bronco busting?
Because we couldn't find you a side saddle, George. Foul, foul, low blow, point to Bush. Now serve, George.
I'm the one who stands for what Americans really love, a kinder, gentler America, and the death penalty.
No sale, George. As time goes on, people will see who I really am. And that I have a vision for this country.
Too bad you have to stand on Lloyd Benson's shoulders to see it.
Foul, foul. There you go, talking about the little shrimp's height again.
Now just
point Dukakis.
You can't do that. I wasn't paying attention.
That's no excuse. I don't know, it,
Nixon. Nixon is a funny guy, though, really.
Isn't he's a bigger-than-life character. Richard Nixon.
Right.
Still around, you know, got my library, nanner, nanner, nanner.
Right.
You know. And I love to do Nixon.
Is Nixon easy to do, Fred? Or
well, the first guy who did Richard Nixon, in fact, he was one of the groundbreaking impressionists and still one of the great talents, is David Fry. Uh-huh. And David, he did things that nobody ever did. And he was the first one to do Nixon. He was the first one to do Buckley, Lyndon Johnson, all kinds of stuff. Uh-huh. And then Rich did Nixon, and then I started to do Nixon. And so I expanded my Nixon. Uh-huh. We all have our own.
Do you guys ever get together, all of you together, at a table or at the Friars Club or any of that, to get together to all these impressionists?
Once in a while it happens.
What happens?
I think the funniest thing I've ever gone through with impressionists, we were talking about Frank Gorshin.
Right.
We did a show in the mid-70s called The Copycats, which was my first national exposure.
Right.
And they wanted a bit on Rod Steiger. Mm-hmm. And so they had, this really happened, this is in England.
Right.
We're all sitting in this office and we don't know why we're there. I said to Frank Gorsh, I said, hi, Frank. He goes, how you doing, Freddie? How are you? What are you here for? I said, I don't know. Uh-huh. In comes Rich. Hi. Hi, Frank. Hi, Fred. Hi. What are you doing here? I said, I don't know why I'm here. He said, well, I don't either. So we go in, and the guy says, we can't decide who does the best Rod Steiger, so we're going to audition at three. Right. I said, thanks. So I did my Rod Steiger. Wait a minute. All right, why do you always yell at me like that? And I sit outside, and then I hear Frank Ocean saying, I don't believe you're going to do... And Rich did his. So they wrote a bit where we did three Rod Steigers.
Right.
And we couldn't get through it. We could not get through it. We all looked alike. We couldn't look at each other.
Right.
Because we were all talking like Rod Steiger.
That's great.
So that was a lot of fun.
But who got it?
We all got it.
We all did three Rod Steigers. But
all
tell me, did you know Fred's a great singer? I mean, just but a great singer.
Thank
Fred,
he does a
really
great Frank Sinatra.
Yes, that's what I'm supposed to ask him. Thank you, darling. You know, Frank Sinatra loves Fred Travalena. You do a great Sinatra. You do all of them great.
But basically,
you do yourself great.
Thanks.
You're a good singer.
Thank you. I got the a treat of all time the other night. I got to sit and watch Frank Sinatra very up close. Saturday night, and he was just, he tore the roof off. I mean, just tore the roof off.
Isn't he great?
Yes, he is. His son, who's an excellent singer in his own right and does his own concert, conducts for Frank Sr. And the nuances that this man gets out of his father's music, and then to watch his father sing in front, very
togetherness
special.
I've never seen them together. Have you seen
very
them together,
very special.
No.
I have never seen
them.
We did see them once in downtown, Frank Jr.
We saw
Jr.
Frank Jr. with his orchestra.
It was great. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was special. I'd love to see that.
Oh, it's incredible.
That would have been great.
Yeah.
Tell me about Fred Travalena writing a book. What's your life?
Well,
go ahead.
I've got a couple of ideas for books. Charles Nelson Reilly, you know Charles. Hello,
Fred, hello. Yeah, when Charles gets upset his eyes, shut up, you know.
I'll bet you I know what you're going to tell me. He's going to write a one-man show for you. Because if anyone could do it, Fred.
Yes, he can.
Am I right?
Yeah. Well, we haven't talked about that so much as a book we're working on.
Okay.
But, he wrote a great show for Burt Reynolds.
Burt Reynolds,
yeah.
Yes.
He's such a talented man, Charles Nelson.
How about a one-man show for Travalena and take the Broadway? Everyone's doing it.
I would love it.
Huh?
I have a concept.
You do?
A couple of people approached me about a year or so ago. I wasn't ready then, but I am ready now.
I can see you just in this living room, all characters doing
working from
one room to the other.
Yep.
Oh, Fred, it'd be wonderful.
Thank
you.
I would love to
actor.
Do it. Yeah, I love to act. I love to sing. I love to.
You like to do dramatics too.
Yeah.
You're really a dramatic actor.
Yeah. I'd love to get in my career some films, some heavy-duty films.
Travalena is not just a singer or a comic or an actor. Entertainer.
Yeah.
Is that what you call it?
Yeah, I would say. That would be the title.
Do you have any regrets in your life right now at all, just looking back over your life? Because you've been through a lot. You lost your both parents, which you loved very much. You loved your parents.
Sure.
Your mother and father, and they were very dear to your heart. You just lost them.
Yeah.
What's Fred doing now? Go ahead.
I'm just I finally got through that. It was pretty tough because it was 9 weeks apart.
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't mean to bring that up, Fred.
No, it's okay.
You
have to get used to not having them around.
Right.
I mean, for the first few months,
it was tough for you.
You go to pick up the phone.
Right.
It's like something good happens and
didn't want to work, did you?
And you can't do it. But I'm working on a lot of different projects, and I want to.
You're married. You have two children.
Married, two boys.
How wonderful!
Two boys who both want to be in the business.
Do they really?
And they're both talented.
Voiceovers? Singing?
Singing, voiceovers, acting. My oldest son, Freddie, wants to be a serious dramatic actor, and he's really good-looking girls. And my youngest guy, Cory, is very funny and dances and sings. So they both have these conversations like, when I become a famous actor, I'm going to make more money than you as a comedian. He says, no, I'm not, because comedians make all kinds of money. Look at Bill Cosby. And this whole conversation goes on. At dinner, I go, guys, I'm still in the business. Do you mind? Well, you can wait a couple of years, you know.
Do you consider yourself a successful person at this time in your lifetime right now?
Not as successful as I'd like to be.
How would you like to be? How would you
I've talked about this with my wife a lot. You know, she's always saying, look, you've done so much already.
And wow.
I haven't, for me. I haven't. What I mean, I'd like to get to where Billy's at and Robin are at. Because
you don't believe
Steve
you're
Martin.
There. I believe you're there.
I haven't put it out there on the box office circuit yet in terms of headlining films or starring
I
in
see.
Films, headlining films. But that's what I need to do.
You don't have bitterness in yourself. I see that.
No, I don't.
You don't waste your time with bitterness.
No, it's a waste of time. And not only that, it makes you sick. It makes you unpleasant, and it destroys you. Uh-huh. And it's a total waste of time. You got to keep going.
Right.
You got to figure out how to make it work.
Right.
Life is a learning experience for the soul.
What have Fred Travalena learned in life so far? What have you learned?
That it goes by very quickly. And do as much good as you can, as hard as that is to do sometimes. And there is a higher power, there is God, and it's in His hands ultimately.
Uh-huh.
You know, and there's a big universe out there. So there
you live here in California,
Fred? Yeah, Encino.
Encino, but you live back east, though. Isn't
I go back
great?
East
all the time
for the leaves.
Well,
I don't go back
the
for the leaves. I am not fit to be lived with between October.
Annie loves
and
it too, don't you, Annie?
Fall and spring,
fourth,
I love it.
The springs, right? Oh, you're from back east. You're in Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
Annie's from Baltimore. Yeah. We met up in the Catskills. Her first singing job. That's the truth. First singing job. Where was it? Some little club up in the Catskills.
It was where people didn't want to be recognized in the audience because they weren't supposed to be with each other.
Oh, is that where it was?
I think it was a no-tell motel or something.
You worked the Catskills a lot, Frank.
Sure.
Some of the favorite hotels up there, did you?
Oh, boy. The Raleigh.
Yeah,
the
right.
Concord, the Kutcher's, Stevensville.
Yeah, great.
Boy, you
Jerry Lewis. Let's get back. Come on.
Jerry Lewis.
Every year you do the Jerry Lewis.
Well, I used to do it every
come
year.
Come on.
Not anymore.
Yes, you do. Why?
Whoa.
Why?
Yes, Jerry.
No, you do too. You do, Jerry.
I did 7 years.
7 years. Was it fun doing it? Yeah, it's
great.
Fun, isn't it?
My musical director now, Bill Rogers,
uh-huh.
is the guy who wrote all the music for all those years.
Uh-huh.
And he conducts for Frank. He conducts for me. He arranges and writes for Frank
uh-huh.
Jr. He's Bill Rogers, and he did all those special arrangements for Jerry all those years. Uh-huh. Still does them.
So what do you think of a young comedian today? They use those four-letter words, but do you advise them to use clean words out there?
I would say if you want...
Welcome to Skippy Lowe's Looking at Hollywood. Today we have the Cannes perennial favorite of all starlets, Edie Williams, who is so hot, hot, hot that she starred in over 31 feature films. None of them that you'd want to bring your children to, but that has not stopped her from going to the Oscars for the 17th time this year without a ticket and has gotten more coverage than some of the Oscar nominees. So now, let's eavesdrop with Skippy.
Edie Williams. I mean,
You said something last year, you're going to come in with something new at the Academy Awards, right? At the Oscars. What was new for Edie Williams this year?
I was very elegant, very tastefully dressed, and totally covered. You know, I've always arrived in, like, my little see-through bikini outfits.
I saw that outfit. Mr. Blackwell even said, totally covered. You call that totally covered?
Yes, I do. My legs were covered. You know, it was bare shoulders, but I was